so pleased with the response that you all guys are all here. So thank you for coming. And I want to welcome you. This is our ninth Cardinal conversation. Mm-hmm. And first one of this year, there'll be five conversations to share. And I'm losing my voice again. You want to talk?
Okay, then. And tip-off starts in about, no, I'm sorry. Well, we're pleased you're here. The dynamics of this event is almost like a salon, in a way, in that we invite individuals to participate, faculty to participate in presentations that are complementary but not of the same disciplines. So, by way of illustration, the very first one was a faculty member whose work was, principal work was being done on Virginia Woolf, and we had a political scientist whose work was in Nazi regime history. And so we looked at the way in which she was informed in her work and how the dynamics contributed to the result of obviously a fascinating piece of literature and a very interesting time in our history. Today, we bring together, I need to have everybody's name here. Today, the topic is communication, culture, and language. Our speakers are Gene Andrews, Chong Min Lee from Deaf Studies, and Jesse, help me with this pronunciation last time. Because I'm no doubt butcher it, and I don't want to do that.
Okay, Doiron.
Doiron. Help me guess.
Absolutely, that was perfect.
Then I'm going to go with that. From the English department, Jesse's going to lead off, and then Gene and Chong Min will follow. And then really the dynamic that makes a salon work is as much this group that will stimulate your thinking, but the dynamic that makes this work is you. Because once they're done, then there's an exchange back and forth. So as Gene knows, many of you know in this room, I've ventured into their territory when we did the investiture. Mm-hmm. I was fascinated with a young man that I met whose parents are deaf, and he was learning ASL to take it out and make a contribution to those that otherwise wouldn't have the opportunity to communicate. So I asked him to help me with the first 45 words or thereabouts of the investiture and stumbled through it. He gave me a C-, which I took passing grade, and I moved on. It's sort of like when you do calculus, you know, you just kind of go, okay, enough of that, move on. So I have a tremendous appreciation and affinity for the work that these folks do, and of course Nancy and my backgrounds are, we're both English undergraduate majors, and certainly have a great affinity for the work of the other representative at the table. So with that, I'll turn it to you all.
Okay, well, I was going to give just a short little intro and then turn the floor over to Jesse. The title of our discussion is A Word With You, Language, Thinking, and Culture. And Jesse is going to talk about one language, English, and then I'm going to up the ante and talk about two languages, ASL and English. And Chong Min is going to up the ante a little more and talk about four languages that in her work, Korean, spoken, reading, and writing, Korean Sign Language, which is different than ASL and English. And so tonight, or this afternoon, we're going to entertain you with some stories which are offshoots from our research in these areas. Now, most of us in this room all hear, and for us, communication is through speech. And, you know, we learn to talk and we learn to read through sound. But for about 7 or 8 people in this room who are deaf, it's not through speech or hearing, it's through vision. And they communicate principally through American Sign Language, which is very different than English. It uses facial expressions and body movement to communicate ideas or words, which is the topic of our presentation. And so if you grow up with English or grow up with ASL, that has a lot of implications on how you learn to communicate, how you learn to think, how you learn language, how you learn play, and how you learn about your culture. So our guest today is, as Dr. Evans pointed out, Chong Min and Jesse and myself. We will start off with Jesse, and he will talk about his very innovative work with prisoners in the Texas criminal justice system and how he uses the English language for rehabilitative and leisure purposes.
Thank you, Jean. I want to apologize, first of all, because the topic that I have is not a real fun one. And usually whenever I've gone to these things, there's been a lot of laughing. So feel free to laugh at any point. Let's all laugh right now and get it over with. I've been going in and out of prison for a dozen years. Not because I'm guilty of that much, at least not that anybody has been able to find out. I go as a volunteer, and I have been doing that much longer than I ever thought I would. When I go into prison, I talk. I use words to explain how I feel about something that happened 32 years ago, which, again, I can't even believe that it's been that long ago, that two men killed me. They killed me by beating me to death with a 3-pound shop hammer, and they ran over my feet and they left me in the snow to die. When they were finally apprehended, the fellows were saying that they had killed me, and they didn't. You can laugh again. Well, when I go in, I try to remember everything that happened because I'm doing it for a purpose. I'm trying to express what it felt like to be a victim, and I do it to offenders, to those people who have perpetrated similar crimes. In fact, sometimes exactly the same crime. And as Jean pointed out, some of us communicate with words and some of us communicate with gestures and facial expressions. And I've discovered that inmates, convicts, offenders, perpetrators often are good communicators in all of those realms, by the way. They're smooth-talking sons and daughters. They know how to wink at the right time. When I go in, I am trying to remember something bad that happened to me, and I'm talking to people who are trying to forget something bad that they did. So you can imagine that the conversations get a little bit weird as we struggle around that idea. And there's a whole lot of faking and fainting and pretending, and it's quite a challenge to get through with words into the psyches, my own as a victim, because God knows there's a lot that I don't really like to talk about when it comes to what happened. There's a lot that I've lied about over the years about what happened. And then they don't want to admit very much. The program's called Bridges to Life. It was started by a man named John Sage, who is about as close to a saint as I've ever got, although I did get Sister Helen Prejean to sign the book that we use. They're both Catholic. Maybe they'll be saints someday. John got started in it the way I did, through crime. Something happened, something terrible. His sister was murdered by 2 19-year-olds, a man and a woman. They used 3 knives, a small statuette to bludgeon her, and then they wrapped her in plastic sheeting and stuffed her in her own closet in the front room of her apartment, where she finally suffocated to death. The two were apprehended, and they were both condemned to death. John, her brother, was condemned to life, a life of remembering, imagining, and despairing. He was a very successful businessman, though, in Houston. And he realized that he could either lose his mind or he could invest heavily and something that was worth living for, and that was the memory of his sister. And that's when he decided to turn his entrepreneurial skills toward the organization of the program Bridges to Life, through which he attempts to take crime and go over it by uniting victims and offenders, not necessarily the same offender with the victim, but people who have been suddenly and rudely interrupted in their life because of crime. The program started in 1998, 17 years now. After 17 years in Navasota, in a place called Luther, it's the Luther Unit for the Texas Department of Criminal Justice, John graduated his 25,000th offender from the program. A truly remarkable feat. And what I delight in is that this program actually started here in Beaumont, Dr. Evans. Down the road, at the LeBlanc Unit on, what is that, 69? You probably drive by it all the time when you're going to Port Arthur. That's where I do my work for Bridges to Life. I go in with my story, but I also go in with a book that was written by Kirk Blaggard, who is now the chairman of the board for Bridges to Life. He wrote the book, and he included my story in the book. He also wrote a workbook. And with those tools and some facilitators from the free world, other victims and also just free worlders like yourselves, if you haven't been touched by crime, God bless you. We can always use you as well. We go in and we try to convince inmates, the offenders, that they have committed crime. That's silly, isn't it? I mean, they've been convicted, right? But it's sometimes difficult for them to admit that with words. Sure, they can admit it with their bodies in the prison, but it's a different thing to say that you've done it. We discuss what's going on in the book, and we discuss what's going on with our presenters, the various victims who come in to give impact statements, we call it, victim impact statements.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
I said... We also, well, I guess we are going to laugh a little bit.
We need it.
One of the other things that we have the inmates do, and this is particularly important for what we're talking about, because we're not discussing this with a lot of educated people all the time. Some of them have got several degrees, but not all. Some of them have no education whatsoever. Some of them are deaf. Not the ones in my program, but in the prison, some of them are non-native speakers of English. We ask them to journal for the entire length of the program. It runs 14 weeks, 3 hours, one night a week for 14 weeks. And they have to journal their experience. It starts out rather rough, and the language is rather rough. There's a lot of hesitancy. But eventually, toward the end, the journaling becomes something of a book. I wish I could publish it, but it's against the rules. Confidentiality. We also ask them, in order to graduate, they have to write a letter. A letter to a family member, a specific family member, a daughter, a brother, a father, a mom. And in that letter, with the words that we have been using through the book and through the presentations, with those new words, which for many of them have come very strained and with great difficulty, they are able to compose a letter admitting their guilt and explaining how they intend to change their lives. That's required. They have to make that statement. How are they going to make things right again? And the final part of the program, in order to graduate, they have to write a letter to the victim. By law, this letter cannot be sent. It cannot be delivered. It cannot be mailed. But it gives them a chance to say what they have been thinking about for 14 weeks. It gives them a chance to say what they wanted to say to their moms and their daughters. It gives them a chance to say something to the man they killed, to the store owner they robbed, to the kid they sold dope to. And it gives them a chance to put into words that empathy which we hope we have taught them. We're not really sure that we've done that good a job, but the recidivism rate for a Bridges to Life graduate is only 14%. It's 17 years. Compare that with the state or the federal, which is 38, 40%. And if you look at the numbers even more in depth, it's not 14% exactly, because a lot of those recidivists end up back in prison because they violated parole. And if you've only got a sixth grade education, you're going to see some of these parole agreements. They're a little complicated. I don't think I could get away with anything if I were on parole. So some of them are technical violations which land them back in prison and they have to finish their sentence. Really, the people who graduate BTL rarely commit a violent crime again. 1 to 3%, depending on the area of Texas. In 2015, Bridges to Life, at the end of the year, will have had 100 projects in 60 different prisons. 500 volunteers working, and hopefully 5,000 more graduates of the program. BTL saves money for the state of Texas because it reduces recidivism. Reduces not only the fact that we have to incarcerate them again, take care of them again, we don't have to prosecute them again. Not only that, they add to the tax rolls because our graduates usually go back and reintegrate into society and become law-abiding, tax-paying. That's really important. And I mean that, not, it sounds funny, but when you pay taxes, you signed on to the social contract. You got a job, and you're willing to say, okay, Uncle Sam, here's your side. And that's something that a criminal might not be inclined to do. Well, let me finish by giving you some examples of what the program actually looks like in C2, is that it? It's like, is that right? This is what happens, okay? Let's say that I've been invited this time, which I was, this was just last week, to go and give my presentation. I tell them what happened. Two guys beat me up with a 3-pound shop hammer. And they ran over my feet, and then they left me in the snow to die. Well, that's the, I make it last longer, okay? I add some stuff to it. I've said it so many times in so many different contexts, so many different audiences. You know, it's kind of like a parable with something for everyone, and depending on the audience, I make it a little bit different. There's some drama, obviously. I try to make a little bit of humor. There's a God moment. Oh, the churches love the God moment. You know, the churches love the God moment. There's a God moment. There's even some wisdom. Don't pick up hitchhikers. Okay, well, maybe not wisdom, but good practical advice, right? I offer my story. It's not easy. Sometimes I have a little bit of a flashback when I'm doing it. Sometimes I get off track. Sometimes I'm not as inspiring as I wanted to be, but I do my best. I sit in the middle when I first get there. The inmates start filing in, and they look odd to me. They're all dressed in white, baggy, stained uniforms. Some of them are handsome, some of them are not. Some of them are old, some of them are young, some of them look like they've had a really hard life of crime, and some of them look like my son. The strange thing is the ones with scars and missing teeth and crooked cross tattoos all across them. They're the ones that come up to me and very warmly shake my hand and thank me for being there. And I wonder, those words, thanks for coming here, how serious are they? I haven't really started the program with them, so I'm a little worried about those words. I'm not sure how serious they are. I have to get into their heads. The only way to do that is by talking. That's how the program works. It's kind of an intense talk therapy. As I said, we have victims and we have offenders. The victims also are volunteers. The victims also are having great difficulty saying what has happened to them. They also are going through the book. They are filling out the workbook and journaling. And the victims, along with the offenders, meet at that bridge. Let me start with a victim impact. I will call her Mary. That's obviously not her name. This is a quote. I was 3 years old the first time I was raped. It's 11 words, neatly lined up, to build the foundation of this woman's life. It was an overpowering moment when she finished that talk. Inmates, free worlders, and victims alike, stunned at her courage and her ability in a prison to talk about this and to admit the difficulty that she had had later in life because of it. Difficulty in marriage, difficulty in jobs. The same difficulties, by the way, that inmates have when they are released. I remember Mary very well. And I think if she could do it, so could I. And the inmates were saying the same thing. If she can do this, then I can too. And it was only 11 words, spoken with great sincerity and directly into the eyes of people who didn't deserve her time. Let me give you the opposite. This is an offender's impact statement. They have theirs as well. We'll call this fellow John. Quote, I don't understand what all of you have been talking about. What is love? What is love? I love Blue Bell. I miss it terribly. I love my wife. This is getting recorded, right? I love you. I love my children. John didn't understand what we were talking about when we talked about love. And it took us a long time to figure out why. But then one night he told us about his father and how his father scourged him almost weekly with wire coat hangers. He took off his shirt. He showed us the scars on his back. He showed us the scars in the back of his mind. It was a long 14 weeks with that man. He was 6'4" and weighed over 300 pounds. He had slit a woman's throat on West Galveston Beach. And as she gurgled out her last words, he mocked her. He has been released to walk among us. And we can only hope that 14 weeks, Kirk Blaggard's book, people like Mary were able to communicate what that word love means. It's a word full of difficult meaning. Here's my last example. Well, shall we call her Jane Doe? Okay. I once, I did some work in a women's prison. It was the Henley unit down in Dayton. And when I went, I didn't really think that my story would have any significance for women inmates. I wasn't really familiar with women inmates. I had no idea what they had done. Sexist, I realized. I just thought women didn't do these kinds of things. And when I found out there was a woman's prison, I was really impressed. I was intimidated. I was very frightened. And I didn't sit in the middle of them. I was too afraid. So I started my story, and I couldn't come up with the words. Usually they come trippingly from my tongue. I was stumbling all over the place, couldn't get it out, couldn't say what I wanted to say. And then I noticed there was a woman, a young woman, slender. She was slumped in her chair somewhere where I would have been sitting at the beginning, but I was too afraid. She was heaving and weeping quietly at first, and then it became audible, almost irritating. And I thought, well, I guess, I'm doing better than I thought. You know, I haven't lost it, you know. The parable is working. The assembled sinners are coming to my understanding. I finished. She never quite finished. And then we broke up into small groups, which is how the program usually works. We have a large meeting, and then we break up into smaller groups. So imagine we all go into the various rooms. We'll stay out of the bedroom. And then 5-10 of you are working on whatever was the main talk, the main chapter. Here's a God moment. I go to my small group, and who's sitting in my circle? As soon as I see her, elbows to her knees, open hands, her face sobbing. So much, there's a puddle at her feet. I am serious. Tears and mucus in this woman. And before I could really say much, she looked at me and she said, with these wretchedly red, puffy eyes, she said, "I did that to you." I looked at her. I didn't remember a woman in my crime. I remembered a dog. They had a dog. The two guys had a dog. And a 3-pound hammer. I remember the hammer. I didn't remember a slender young woman. And she said, "That was me." What she meant was that she was a party to a similar crime. Her pimp, a lot of dope, some beer, another guy, and they killed a man on an interstate, threw him over, took off with his car. I looked at the woman, and then she said, "I never thought I'd have the chance to say, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. So sorry." And I looked at her and I said, not being the man that she had killed, I said, "I know." And I did. I knew what she meant. She had lost everything because of that crime. She was afraid that she was going to lose her soul because of that crime. She had already lost all respect for herself. And now she was trying to fight back and gain something through the program. "I'm so sorry, so sorry." The rules in a woman's prison are very strict about physical contact and volunteers. There's no hugging, just words. Just words to embrace. It's your word now.
I think we ought to just go home. No, that was great. Jesse, thank you. And what occurred to me in your talk, in your discussion, was that the words that you use with the prison inmates are, you know, words that soothe and that rehabilitate and, you know, the beauty, the power of the English language. And mine is completely different. I'm going to turn the discussion 180 degrees, and I'm going to talk about English words as being barbed wire and as presenting barriers for the deaf inmate. So Jesse and I both share a similar setting. We're both in prison a lot, in jail, or in court. And but my situation, my work with deaf inmates is very different with hearing inmates than Jesse's is with hearing inmates. Jails and prisons are really set up for hearing people. They're auditory environments full of buzzers and people talking and rules and loudspeakers and rule books and things to read. And for a deaf person, it's a big place of isolation. And one of my areas of research is how to inform the courts, how to inform judges and lawyers and correctional officers and police departments how they can provide accommodations for deaf inmates. And it's not volunteer. Usually it involves a lawsuit. I've been called in to help get some rights for deaf, for a deaf offender or a deaf suspect. And it involves using words to test them as to what their communication abilities are. You know, how can they, what are their speech abilities? What are their lip reading? What are their reading and writing? And what about their signing abilities? And most people in the criminal justice system have never met deaf people before. A judge might see two deaf people in his career, the same with an attorney or in a prison or jail, because it's a low incidence disability. So it's, and it's an invisible disability, and it's a linguistic cultural difference. So people are unaware of that, and part of my job is to educate the judges and the police and the criminal justice on exactly what's unfair about this situation with the deaf person in jail. And it doesn't mean we excuse them if they're serial killer or serial rapist or, you know, or you know, a burglar or any of those crimes. It's not to excuse them, but it's to make sure that they have the equal opportunity in jail, just as hearing inmates have. So one of the things I wanted to talk about, and I'm going to have some case studies too, like Jesse did, is myths about deafness. A lot of legal people and police and criminal justice people think that every deaf person can lip read. That even though they can't hear, they can lip read everything perfectly. And that's a myth. Lip reading is very difficult, and we have some speech pathologists in the audience, they would attest to this, is that a lot of the sounds, especially the vowels, are made inside the mouth. And a lot of the consonants are made on the lips and they look alike. So a deaf person, especially if they're born deaf, may lip read maybe 5% of a conversation. So when a police officer, you know, pulls over a deaf person and wants to talk to them and they find out they're deaf, they'll think, oh, they can lip read, and they won't bother to call an interpreter. They don't think that an interpreter is necessary. Another myth is that every deaf person can read. If they can't hear, they can't lip read, they can read. But the research shows is that most deaf people, when they leave school, they read at the third or fourth grade reading level. And of course, that's different than all the deaf people here at Lamar. I mean, they're college level and they read much higher. But for the average deaf person, when they get out of school, they read very low. And, you know, as I mentioned earlier, English is barbed wire for them, for deaf. You know, they can't read the inmate handbook. So how do they know the rules are in the prison? And, you know, a hearing inmate can be illiterate, but they can say, you know, hey, Joe, what does this mean? I'm not supposed to, you know, do this or clean up my cell or whatever. Or they'll ask the correctional officer, explain that to me again, I don't get it. But a deaf inmate doesn't have an interpreter, and they have nobody there to help them through that. And they are subject to bullying, to rape, to even murder. So it's a very dangerous place for a deaf person in jail. Another misconception is that they can all sign. Not all deaf people use sign language. And there's a, you know, there's a continuum from very poor signing to very high signing. And many of these deaf suspects or inmates had very poor education. They got signing very late in life, so they can't use interpreters. And so they can't work with their attorney, because they can't work with an interpreter and their attorney. They can't understand the proceedings that's happening in court. And this is a real problem for the courts, because on one hand, you know, if they're accused of murder or rape or sex offending, they don't want to let them go. But on the other hand, how do they accommodate them? How do they make sure that their constitutional rights are given to them just as hearing? And that's where I come in to educate the courts on these issues. There's also a lot of problems during the arrest. The policeman comes to a house for domestic violence. And let's say two deaf people are having a domestic fight. The policeman, instead of calling an interpreter, will listen to the person with the best speech and hear that person's side of the story and not the deaf person's side of the story. So they can make an arrest, they can take them to jail without really understanding what's going on. So that happens a lot with policemen, that they don't know enough because they haven't had the training to contact an interpreter. Another problem they do is they handcuff the deaf person behind the back. And so the deaf person can't use their signing or their gestures to communicate. Another thing is they show them the Miranda warning in print on a little card, and they find out they're deaf. They say, well, read this. Now, do you understand that? And the deaf person wants to get along, so the deaf person smiles and nods, because we're all afraid of policemen, right? So they sign their name saying they understand it when they really don't. And so that's another area of research that my students and I have worked on, is doing readability analysis of the Miranda warning. It's written, I think, at the 7th grade reading level. And so most deaf people can't read it. Then there's the problem when they get to jail. If you've ever been booked to jail before, you're fingerprinted, and that's easy to follow what to do. But they are required to do a medical and psychological intake, and that requires an interpreter. And many jail officials won't call the interpreter. They'll simply, do you have diabetes? You know, or do you take drugs for depression? They'll a checklist for the deaf person, have them sign their name. And they really haven't gotten the information they needed. And I've been involved in cases where the deaf person was not provided an interpreter and they committed suicide. They were put in isolation. This one case that I worked on several years ago, they were put in jail. The young man suffered from depression, and it wasn't picked up at the medical intake because there was no interpreter. And they put him in isolation thinking they could protect him from other inmates, because he couldn't communicate with them, and he hung himself. The family came back and sued the police department and got a settlement. Another issue that I work with is that sometimes an inmate will get into prison and nobody knows sign language, and the prison refuses to provide an interpreter because it costs money. So they'll teach a hearing buddy, how to sign, to be their interpreter. And I mean, it sounds like a easy solution, but you know, as the deaf students in the front line are shaking their head, I mean, you can't do that. You can't teach someone ASL in 20 minutes, maybe to play Uno or a card game, but not to go with you to your counselor. And this happened in jail, where an inmate taught his buddy how to sign to kind of cope, and the prison official sent the hearing buddy, along to the counseling session. And so when the hearing buddy got back, what did he do? Blah, 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 told all the other inmates that this guy was in for sex offending, and he was beat up. This is common. This has happened in two cases that I've worked on. No closed captioning in TV. Of course, a lot of them, deaf inmates, can't read the captioning on TV, but some can. And that, I mean, what are they going to do with their time? They can't read books, so they watch a lot of TV. And not having closed caption is really not fair to them. So that's another issue that we talk about. No visual alerting devices. one, and this was a least security type of jail, and this guy kept missing breakfast because he would sleep through it, and no one was there to wake him up, and he didn't have an alarm clock. And, you know, it sounds like such a little thing, but when you're in prison, you know, breakfast is a big thing. So, I mean, these are the kinds of things that snag deaf people when they get in prison, and that that the whole prison system and the judicial system need education on how to accommodate deaf inmates. Because if they don't, then the ADA, a good lawyer with the American with Disabilities Act 504, can come back and there can be serious consequences. And most of the consequences have to be with a stipulation that the court, I mean, that the police department or the prison develop training for their officers. So there's a lot of good that comes out of these law cases. Well, I'm going to kind of summarize by talking about two case studies. I talked about one about the young man that killed himself. Another case that I was in Beaumont a couple summers ago, and it was really one of the most riveting. It's publicized on the internet, so I'm not breaching any confidentiality. But this was a 55-year-old deaf man, African American, was legally blind. And he worked 30 years in the hospital as a janitor, saved up his money, bought his own house. His sister helped him with bill paying because he had some cognitive disabilities too, but he was pretty much independent. But he was a fragile type 1 diabetic, and he required nurses to come 3 times a day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, to take him into the kitchen and to help him with his insulin. And he did this without no problem, you know, no felony, no criminal activity, nothing. All of a sudden, one LVN nurse comes along and says that this man sexually assaulted her. And he was charged, and he had to get a lawyer. His family got him a lawyer. And the lawyer called our department and contacted me. And so I did what I do in all these cases, I do a communication evaluation. So I tested his reading level. It was first grade, 55. I had to use big print because of his visual impairment. I also got, you know, his history, and he used he didn't have very good ASL. It was mostly gestures and acting out, very primitive kind of language. His mother took him out of school and kept him at home for lots of years, but for some reason he got this training and he got this job, and he, you know, was doing okay. No history of criminal activity. And basically, when these types of people, deaf people with these kind of backgrounds, we make the case to the court that they're linguistically incompetent. That might be a new term. You know what a mentally incompetent is, but linguistically incompetent means they don't have strong ASL and they don't have strong English. And typically, we can get the case settled or dismissed on that. But this judge says, no, I'm not going there. This is a serious, you know, case. We're going to go ahead with the trial. And so the judge said, the lawyer said, you know, with consultation with me and with others, like the National Association of the Deaf, it's not just me, there's a whole, you know, army of disability lawyers who have, you know, great background in deafness-related things that the lawyers always consult, and not just me. And what they said is that for this trial, we need to have a CDI. And a CDI is called a Certified Deaf Interpreter. What that means is that the hearing interpreter, like Aaron over there, who's translating my speech, my talk. So if Aaron was in that courtroom, he would translate what the judge said, or the lawyer. And then the deaf interpreter would be right beside Aaron, or in front of Aaron, and would be receiving his sign and breaking the signs down to simpler signs. Okay, so it's two interpreters, a hearing interpreter and a deaf interpreter, work as a team to break down the language to even simpler concepts, give examples. Most judges don't like this because it creates a circus in their courtroom. because, you know, here we have two interpreters, but in a courtroom you'll have two, and then two, you know, take their place, and then you'd have the CDIs, and then you'd have another one take their place, plus you'd have to have like an orchestra leader, the one who was, you know, supervising all this. So in the side of the courtroom there are like 15 people. And you know, the judge is going, what is going on? You know, attorney, you know, you need to explain this to me. And so that's part of my job too, is to explain all of this to the judge and to the jury on why we need this because of this man's communication background. It was a really tough case because the accuser was very, very polished. She was dressed to the nines, you know, perfect makeup, and she had tears rolled, and her story on how this deaf man grabbed her and pushed her out the door, and you know, you could just see the empathy from the jury. But then they put the deaf man up on the stand, and with the help of the CDI interpreters, he could tell his story. And his story was that she came into the house, woke him up, pulled his arm, she was in a hurry, pulled his arm to the kitchen, pushed him into the chair, you know, grabbed the insulin, and you know, by then he was kind of pushing her off, and that, you know, he said he was in a daze, you know, his diabetes was acting up the last couple days, and you know, the medicine wasn't quite right. And so with the aid of the CDI, he was able to explain his part of the story. And then also when the prosecutor started asking him questions, he couldn't answer because the prosecutor's language was too technical and too difficult. And so, you know, all of this was context, deaf culture, that in deaf culture you don't grab a deaf person by the arm and pull them. I mean, that's considered very hostile and very aggressive. So all of these kinds of things have to be explained to the judge about deaf culture, about ASL, about low language. And so that, you know, that is what I do in my area of work. Now I'm going to end with one last case study, and this has to do with children, juveniles. One case, actually it was two cases, there were two boys in Texas is the only state that does this, put kids in jail. It's a large state prison for boys in Giddings, Texas. I think there's 300 deaf hearing boys there that are there for, you know, heinous crimes, killing grandmothers and, you know, having sexually abusing their infant brothers and sisters. It's very, very sad. But they put these two deaf boys in there, and they did provide interpreters for class, during their schooling, 5 hours of school, but they didn't provide interpreters for after school in the dorm, or they didn't provide them during their sex offending treatment program. So these poor boys had to sit there and, you know, listen. They couldn't hear and they couldn't understand, but they weren't allowed to participate in the rehabilitative part of this program. And also their textbooks for this program were written at the 10th grade reading level, and that was where I come in. I come in and I do a readability analysis of the textbooks, find that they're 10th grade, the boys are reading at 3rd grade, judge what's wrong with this picture. They're not getting accommodations. So, you know, that's another part of what I've been doing. And the last case is another heart wrencher, and this was a little Hispanic girl in the Valley who was in the 7th grade, and her parents were embarrassed about her being in special ed. So they said, we don't want her in special ed, we want her in the regular classroom. She had a little bit of Spanish, a little bit of English spoken, no sign. Well, she sat in the back of the classroom until one day she picked up a chair and threw it at her teacher and put the teacher's back out. Teacher had to go to the hospital. The parents later admitted to the school that she was on bipolar medication. You know, they were too embarrassed to tell the school that. So they put this girl in a juvenile justice facility, and again, it wasn't appropriate for her. They interpreted for her classes, but she didn't have any interpretation of the dialogue that was happening between the other kids and the teachers, and that's where the teachable moments really come up with these juveniles. So the court got her out of there quick. She had a very good advocacy lawyer. And we decided we were going to send her to a school for the deaf for a summer camp. And she hated it. The boys and girls bullied her. You know, we thought ASL and deaf culture would save her, but it really didn't in the beginning. She was bullied, you know, and she was belonged to a religious sect and had to wear long dresses and her hair up in a bun and long sleeves, so they made fun of her. So they brought her back to the school, but she went into a deaf ed classroom and she started to take ASL classes from a deaf Hispanic woman teacher. And they bonded, and she was able to provide her with role modeling. And so she was able to complete her high school in a better situation. So to sum up, English is barbed wire for deaf inmates, but it's soothing for hearing inmates. And now we're going to transition to Chong Min, and she's going to talk about four languages, Korean, spoken, reading, and writing, which is used by 80 million Koreans, Korean Sign Language, which is by 300,000 deaf Koreans, ASL, or English and ASL, and how those four languages influenced her.
Yes, my story is more focused on my personal experience and, you know, how I am successful and made it here today. I'm not meaning to be bragging or boastful, but I'm just wanting to share my experience. I am from South Korea, and I moved here to America 10 years ago to study for my PhD. And I received my PhD degree in education from Ohio State University. And you're probably wondering, why did I pick Ohio State? General deaf education is always under special ed, but at Ohio State, it's under general education. And so I believe that, you know, physical disability is different from deafness. That a physical disability, or, you know, you could have a mental disability as well. But a deaf person doesn't have a mental disability or a physical disability either. It's just language. It's just you're different and you use a different language and you can still learn. And so that's why I chose Ohio State, because it matched my belief. I grew up in the hearing world, and I felt like I was the only deaf person because everyone was hearing. I was very isolated. I have a wonderful family and I'm wonderful friends, wonderful instructors, but I still felt like something was missing as I was growing up. And then later I learned about the deaf community in Korea. I was able to, you know, seek them out, find them, and started learning Korean Sign Language. I was almost graduating college at that time. Like the last 2 months of college, I found the deaf community there in Korea and became, you know, immersed in that culture. And learning Korean Sign Language really had a big impact on my life and really changed my life. I grew up, you know, trying to be a part of the hearing world, hearing, you know, people were all the same. They could speak and they could hear. I could speak, you know, Korean. My parents worked very hard with me every day growing up. They really sacrificed a lot of time teaching me to speak. So I could speak almost 80% clarity. And I was, you know, happy growing up, and I could speak, but I could not hear. But everyone else could speak and hear, but I couldn't hear. So I had problems with self-esteem, and I also felt like something was missing, and that I needed, you know, some kind of support group that I could really share my feelings with and had something in common with. And so that's why I sought out the deaf community. And I really enjoyed learning a new language, a new culture, and they taught me how to survive in the hearing world, how to overcome some of the barriers, and that's what they helped me with, and to make me more confident. And so that's, because of that, I decided to move to the United States, and I moved here alone. And I thought about I wanted to move to America, and I discussed it first with my parents. And my parents, their first question they asked me was, if you go to America, how will you communicate? They won't know how to speak Korean there, and so how will you communicate? And that was their first question. Also, our family physician was concerned because I grew up able to speak, that if I don't continue speaking, then I could lose my voice, and encouraged me not to move to America. But I felt differently. That I felt like it doesn't matter which language modality you use, that's less important, whether you use your voice or whether you use sign language. Communication is what's important. And that's what was important to me, that I can communicate using sign language, so I can still move there, why not? And so I convinced the rest of my family, and I moved to the United States. And I studied for my PhD, but I had challenges for three reasons. One, because of learning English and learning American Sign Language at the same time. So that was challenging, because I moved here and I wasn't able to quickly start my PhD studies. I mean, I started my PhD studies quickly while I was learning ASL and English at the same time. Also, there were some cultural conflicts as well. There's American hearing culture and Korean hearing culture. There's differences between the two. Then there's Korean deaf culture and American deaf culture, and there's differences between those. And so there was continuous conflicts that would happen, and that I had to continually learn those cultural differences. One example is like eye contact for deaf people is very important, because we depend, you know, on a visual language. So you need to be able to look at each other. If you want to be able to talk, communicate, discuss anything, you have to have eye contact. That if you look away from a deaf person, it means you don't want to communicate with them, or you refuse to, and it's considered rude. But in hearing culture, it's different. You don't depend on the visual so much. You're able to still hear, and you can look away and still hear and still carry on a conversation. But for deaf people, it's different. So there's a funny story that in Korean culture, that if you want to talk with an older Korean person, you can't look at them in the eye. It's not appropriate behavior. You have to divert your gaze to show respect. That if you look them in the eye, it means you're challenging them. It's rude. That you want to, you know, get in an argument, debate something with them. So those conflicts happen often between the hearing culture of the two and deaf culture in the two countries as well. And so I had to learn that in order to continue to communicate as well. Really, how I learned English and how I learned ASL was because I had a very strong foundation of Korean language and of Korean sign language. So having that strong foundation makes it easier to learn another language like English and ASL. Before I moved to the United States, I envisioned what my future would be. I wanted to teach American hearing students, and now that's coming true for me. That's what I'm doing. And I'm really enjoying teaching hearing students every day. Last year, the president of the university awarded me a $75,000 grant to establish a research lab. And this research lab is very important because in the deaf education field, focus has always been on language, related to language. And deaf people are able to communicate, able to use ASL to communicate without any problems, but it's academic language that can be challenging, because academic language is English, and you know their literacy skills are required, but ASL is a visual language and there's not a written form. That if you want to, you know, read and write, then you have to learn English. And so they struggle with that. And so looking back at the first, you know, deaf people, when I first met deaf people, I struggled to learn Korean Sign Language. And then after associating with them, I seen that they were weak in their Korean language, reading and writing of that. And I asked why, and no one could give me a real clear answer. And so, you know, I wondered about that, and I wanted to find an answer. And so that's another reason why I wanted to move here. And during my PhD studies, I realized that their cognitive processing is different because of the language, spoken language, and then for a ASL or a visual language, it's different. Your cognitive processing of that language is different. And it means that their learning process and the way and how they learn is different. And sometimes a hearing teacher trying to teach deaf children, deaf students, the way that they're teaching, their teaching method may not be as successful because of that. And so my research lab is focused on cognitive processing and how it's different and how that impacts learning. Also, my area of research, you know, I said often they focus on language. Many deaf students struggle with learning math. And so I'm focused on researching math and cognitive processing and language together. And hopefully will help deaf students in the future with their learning. Before, I struggled to learn ASL, and so I think I can benefit hearing students now that are learning ASL because of my experience and how I learned it will benefit them. And then I struggled learning English, and I think my experience can help me in teaching deaf students improve their literacy skills. And so I'm real excited about this opportunity in my research lab, and I'm really looking forward to having doing my research with faculty and students, and I'm hoping, you know, to find some way to improve and give back to the deaf community. And I believe that the deaf community's future can be bright because of this and our research.
Well, Jesse, you want to sum everything up?
No.
Can we move right to the Q&A?
Yes, let's do.
So, folks, you don't need to raise your hand or anything. Just ask your questions.
I have a question for Dr. Chong Min Lee. Which language was easier to learn, English or American Sign Language?
My answer, it depends on the language environment. If I, you know, was immersed in the deaf community, then it was easier to learn ASL because I had that everyday exposure and interaction. But English, I had, you know, accessibility problem because it's a spoken language, and so trying to, you know, learn that was a challenge. And then, you know, being able to read and write English was a challenge too, because my foundation, my first language, was a spoken language.
I have a question. In our prehistory, is there any information on did language or sign language evolve at the same time? Did one come before another? Do we have any knowledge of that?
Dr. Clark, I'm gonna pass the yield to her.
It depends on who you ask. The person who first identified American Sign Language as a language is named Bill Stokey, and his name's mine. And it's very interesting. He taught English at Gallaudet and knew no sign language. But what he noticed was a lot of statistical regularity, so he identified it as a language. And then over the years, as he moved away from Gallaudet and he really focused on the origins of language, he became convinced that sign was the primary language. And then they added the spoken words to that. Now, not everybody agrees with that. But there is a theory that sign was the original because you could communicate visually what we needed to do. We have to work together. And then with the vocalizations, they put words on top. There is an organization called the Language Origins Society, and it's always fun to go to those meetings because they struggle with this because it doesn't leave fossils. And so we don't really know how it developed. But there is a theory, and David Armstrong is currently continuing that research to say that sign language was the original language and then spoken language was added on top.
Where would like two-dimensional cave art, Upper Paleolithic times, how does that symbolism, that's a language of some sort.
Writing.
That comes later, I assume. But.
Well, it's iconicity, and there's a wonderful talk, and I can give you the link if you'd like, by Carol.
That's what you tell me.
By Carol Patton, who got one of the Genius Awards a couple years ago, the MacArthur Award. And she worked with Stokey as a child, as an infant, basically. And she has come to change her mind because he originally identified specific, he called them terimes, which are really like phonemes. And she has come to change her mind, and she now has a theory that all languages have a lot of iconicity, just like those cave drawings, and that that's one of the reasons why deaf people pick up a new sign language, sometimes in a week and sometimes definitely in a month, because the iconicity is more obvious in the signs, whereas in our spoken languages, some of that iconicity is gone. Though some of it is still there when we talk, we use words, excuse my language, like barf. So the iconicity is still in some of the spoken language, but not as much as the spoken language.
Officially, though, I like that.
The barf.
I'm so glad I said that. You combine them.
I think that was what comes to mind is I read about when tool use, when the caveman and cavewoman had to start using the tool use, then they started occupying their hands, and then speech came in because their hands were busy.
And then they started to decorate.
Yes. 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 Yes.
Actually, Jesse, this is not an ASL connection to what you're doing, but it's a visual connection. Where inmates may have a difficult time articulating or appreciating the articulation of what they had done to their victims. Have you all used imagery or art as a form of trying to connect people with their past criminal behavior, helping them kind of work their way through it that way?
Not in Bridges to Life, no.
Okay.
However, I also teach with Lamar State College, Port Arthur, as an adjunct at the Stiles. And they have at Lamar State College a similar publication, Our Pulse, I think they call it Expressions. And if you go through the last few years of Expressions, almost, I'd say, the past 5 years, first, second, or third place has always been an inmate. And they teach art. Lamar State College does. And a lot of that, it doesn't really work directly. It doesn't deal with their crimes in particular, but you see a lot of angst coming out in their artwork. And I can't tell you how often I've been to one of my classes, which are English classes, literature classes, or composition classes, and an inmate comes up and shows me drawings and various things that he's doodled either in class or he's getting it ready. One incident with Bridges to Life I can remember, this was at the Jester 3 unit, which is a unit outside of Houston, and it's for disabled inmates. And as I was leaving after giving my presentation, one of the inmates tried to give me a caricature or a drawing, actually. It was not a caricature. It was a pretty nice drawing. I wanted to keep it, but it's against the rules, you know. He tried to give it to me, so I took it, and then I had to give it to the guard, and the guard said, no, you can't have it. Tore it up. So in a way, you can see the expressive need and the value of it, and it's usually recognized. I mean, they do allow them art. It's just that it's not always true for every correction official. Every correction officer doesn't have the background, the training, or the interest in stimulating that kind of expression.
There's to connect with Dr. Evans' statement, there's a photography exhibition at the Manil of an artist, a photographer who was pen pals with Texas inmates on death row for about a decade, and she collected their drawings and also did some photography, and it's an awesome show. I think it's still playing playing, still showing at the Manil, but she was able to capture a lot of the art that they had would send her through pen pals.
I have a question. This is for Dr. Lee. I was just wondering, how did your Korean Sign Language and spoken Korean Sign Language help you with your ASL and English language acquisition?
The language acquisition, the theories, and the specific, you know, goal of that helped with learning and also motivation. I had, you know, a goal in what I wanted to learn for. And so every day before, you know, I moved here, I planned to take the GRE. And every day I would, you know, study and memorize and learn 500 to 600, you know, words. And I did that for almost 2 years. And that helped me to acquire English. And also I used, you know, myself, I would, you know, didn't have, you know, much to do as far as with deaf people, so I would look at a lot of books and try to figure out, read the books, memorize words from the books, and, you know, but I had a goal, I had motivation, and so without that, then, you know, it may have been more of a struggle. So it's important to have a goal set, that what you want for your life.
And I'm also wondering, you said that you were memorizing 500 to 600 words a day, so before you moved here. So is that a still a habit that you have now, or what do you do now?
No. The foundation of the language was weak, and so I needed to, you know, strengthen that and build that. That no, if I continue doing that, it'd kill me. So no, I, you know, my foundation for English was weak, and I wanted to build it up and make sure it was strong, and I had to do that with learning vocabulary, and I did that for 2 years, almost 500, 600 words a day.
Wow, I like that.
I have a question. What are your thoughts on the importance of body language? I was a student of Professor Jesse here, and I also actually had the privilege of going into a prison and meeting with some convicts or inmates, they prefer whichever of the terms, and I noticed whenever I sat down with them in a book club that they were intent on watching whoever was speaking, and they were watching how you're moving, how you're speaking, your tone, and then they could also turn that around on you and make you feel good and then try to pull information out of you. I was just curious, do y'all have any input on the importance and the strength of body language?
Yes, for ASL, it's a grammatical feature that there's, you know, five components. There's hand shape, movement, location, palm orientation, and your facial expression. So like for hearing people, your vocal inflection of whether you're sad, happy, angry, is in your vocal inflection. But for deaf people, you know, there's no voice, so how do you show that? It's with facial expression. So there is a grammatical feature using your facial expression that if you're mad, you know, you have to have that facial expression to match that. If you're happy, you have to have that facial expression to match that. So, and it's just visually clear, honest. And so, you know, to be more skilled with ASL, it's important to practice the facial grammar.
And just to add to that, I don't teach the class. There's other people in the room that teach the class on ASL grammar, but there's all sorts of, you know, head leans and head tilts and eyebrow raises that do signal different grammatical forms. So body language for a deaf person, an ASL user, is grammatical and linguistic, whereas body language for a hearing person like the inmates, it's more to support their vocal, their speech.
To get into the prison, Michael, I have a class of 22 inmates, and it's a very different experience working with inmates because I don't want to make it sound like it's lions and I need a whip and a chair, but if I'm working with a few inmates, it's a lot easier than working with 22 because a lot goes on around you, and it is sign language, but it's prison argot sign language. I don't even know what it would be called, but I mean, they have a lot of signs that they're shooting to each other, and I have really no idea what they're trying to get across. And of course, I'm cautioned and told that if I notice it, that they're dealing anything or doing something they shouldn't be doing, I'm supposed to inform, but you can't really tell. And if I ask them, they say, I'm not doing anything. Yeah. So what do you mean? Another aspect of the body language is that you really do have to carry yourself in a very assured way. You are communicating to the inmates that you are unafraid. And some instructors can't do that. And I'm talking about teaching now, not in Bridges to Life, because their groups are smaller. And they're also more receptive because they are volunteers for the program. So there's they're letting it down, thank God. They're letting down this aggression. But sometimes, if you're just walking through a prison, it's the way you carry yourself, and that's just body language. And they are very good at sensing fear. And as you remember, when we walked through the exercise yard, you were in that group, right, when we were going through, and that was a maximum security. And I don't like it, but you know, you have to force yourself to look them in the eye. As you were pointing out, it's a very important part of that communication, and to go back or to look down or to shy away, that's definitely signaling them. And at the same time, they're doing the same thing to you, kind of pushing themselves. Clint Eastwood. I keep channeling Clint Eastwood. Just be Clint Eastwood.
Well, you know, interesting, another aspect of body language, especially for cons, is the way you tell if they're really lying is through their body language, because they're very good at masking, and there's some very minimal eye things that a really good person can tell if they're really lying. It actually is used to detect a sociopath and one that is lying. And so they're very good at looking at your body contact, because then they manipulate you.
It's absolutely
that way.
True.
It's really,
absolutely true.
It's a skill that they've learned. And my, in a prior, three lives back, I think, my first full-time job, I was a therapist in a residential treatment center. And you learn fast. You learn a lot, really fast. And when they come at you with their fist, you don't flinch. You just sit there. And that's how you survive in that kind of environment. But body language is really important to those people, because their whole childhood, that's how they knew what was coming. The verbal language didn't match the body language, and they were looking at that body language to figure out what was going to happen next.
Yeah, in fact, Dr. Clark, what the prisons, when you're a volunteer, you have to go through a lot of training all the time. I get trained twice a year, sometimes thrice a year, and you get recertified. And there's a lot of stuff that you have to go through to work regularly in the prison. And the part that always I find amusing now is the part on body language and proximity, because there are so many restrictions as to what you can do, how you can touch an inmate, or what an inmate can do with you, as in touching. And especially with women who are volunteers, you know, a gesture like this by an inmate is a threat. Even just, oh, excuse me, can I, and then a reach, that's that kind of proximity is it's a reportable offense, actually. And of course they say, you know, don't just think of yourself as a woman with men doing it. Men, you should also report it, because they're doing the same thing to you. So not just what they're doing, but how close they're doing whatever they're doing becomes an issue. Yeah, I had to get with me about the eye thing, though.
Do you think nonverbals become more important in among inmates simply because their language proficiencies are so relevant?
No. No, I don't. I mean, some of my most articulate inmates are the ones that have perfected. I mean, they're very high-level speakers of body language, but I don't think it's just because they don't have the words. It really is sometimes the only way they can communicate. For example, in my classes have large windows. I'm not going to touch it. They have large windows so that the correctional officers walking around can see what's going on. You know, I'm not closed into a room. And inmates are going by. It's quite irritating. You know, you get used to all this kind of rigmarole. There's a lot of interruption visually. And I'll see an inmate. I know that his buddy's going by because of what, I don't know what he's saying, but I know that there's something that he just said. And if I actually asked the guy, he said, I was just telling him that I'm going to see him after chow.
Mm-hmm. A secret sign language.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I don't know what it is, but it's not because they're dumb. These guys are very well read.
Well, the deaf have secret sign language in prison, too. Huntsville, there's a, used to be 99 deaf prisoners. They all have in one unit, the Estelle unit, and which makes good sense because you can centralize interpreters and services. But one of our Lamar students did a dissertation on interviewing them. And she found that there's Texas prison signs mm-hmm. that they use among themselves. And you know, a lot of it's for communication, and a lot of it is to be secretive from the guards. So I imagine hearing have gestures and gang signs.
The gang signs, that alone, you know, there's a huge list of gang signs. I, you know, sometimes I'll do something and they'll laugh, you know, and go, okay, who did I just signal? You know, or what did I say?
Well, this has just been terribly interesting, and really thank you all for your talk and conversation. Just very lots of thought-provoking things, would you guys agree? And anyway, just to thank you all. I know, Jean, you're retired. You don't need one of these things.
Oh, I need them even more to organize my stuff.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you all so much.
That was great. Yeah, you did a good job too. Thank you.